everyone, welcome back to the Amplify Your Confidence podcast season 2. Oh my god, it has been a long time. I haven't recorded any new episode, but here I am. I'm back. Spring of 2023 is coming. That means we're gonna bring in a new lineup for our guest speakers. And today I'm super excited to introduce to our guest speaker, Jordan, my dear friend here in Europe. And before we're gonna go into the topic today, coping with loss, breaks up, and changing identities with her, I would like to give you guys a little bit of introduction about my friend. So, Jordan C, an entrepreneur, writer, strategist, and a travel lover. As the founder of Creatively White, she seeks opportunity to help brands go their impact to storytelling and work with inspirational people. Originally comes from a small town in Ohio, US, she has traveled and worked in more than 30 countries since 2019 from just a one-way ticket she bought by then. Her stories, experience, and personalities are unique, and I'm so thankful we met each other and become such a good friends. Even more than thankful she agreed to join me in this podcast. I cannot wait to dive in the conversation with her today. Everyone, please again welcome the pretty, smart, and kind-hearted Jordan on the Amplify Your Confidence podcast. Thank you for joining me today. Okay. So before we dive into our topic, normally I gonna go through a game with our guest speaker, so the audience gonna know more about you. So it called hot seat questions. So you cannot think. I gonna give you 5 questions, and then whatever comes first in your mind, you're gonna let me know your answer. Are you ready?
Yeah, I guess so.
Okay, so the first question is the questions I always ask every single guest speakers come to the podcast, because it's about amplify your confidence. So the first one would be, what does confidence mean to you?
I think confidence means feeling comfortable in your own skin and being able to walk into any room and just feel really sure about yourself.
You know what I find fascinated about the questions I have so far? Now you are the 11th guest on my podcast. And everyone has different answers how they think about confidence. The second one, when was the last time you cried?
Probably yesterday.
Oh,
I'm a frequent crier. For me, it's like a good release of emotions. I happy cry, sad cry. Sometimes I cry and I don't know why. So probably yesterday.
And how do you feel now?
Better.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Good. Just want to check in. What is your most recent learning about yourself, or people, or the world around you?
Ooh, that's a tough one. I think I'm still learning more about like how I process things and information. And I'm learning more and more that like sometimes I have a bit of like an anxious response to certain things. And so I think one of the key things I've learned this last year is to like pause before reacting to things and give myself enough time to process versus just jumping into my reaction.
Yeah, because sometimes I feel like we just feel like, oh, I need to do it now. But actually, you can take a little bit, even just 10 minutes before you want to make
the decision. Yeah, exactly. Not feeling as rushed in things.
Okay, cool. What are the most proud things you can tell a 10-year-old Jordan?
I think probably the biggest one is that I've traveled. I definitely didn't grow up from like in a family where we traveled or had passports or anything like that. So I think just the fact that I've spent so much time in the last few years abroad would be something I'm proud of. The fact that I own my own company. And yeah, I think 10-year-old me would think it's pretty cool that I have friends from all over the world. So
yes, and we definitely gonna know more about this story. Yeah. In the next part of our conversation.
Yeah.
What does a perfect day look like for you? And this is the last questions already, so you're doing so well.
Okay. I think the perfect day definitely includes a start with coffee.
Mm-hmm.
Like coffee, some kind of like physical activity in the morning, and then the beach. And then I love spending time with friends, so probably some kind of dinner or activity in the evening with friends and people I love. And yeah, just taking it easy. No work is involved in my perfect day.
I love it. Yeah, so that's it. That the five questions to let the audience know more about you.
Right.
And now we're going to move to the next part. Today we're going to talk about how we cope with loss, with breakups. It's not just about romantic breakups, can be friendship and changing identities, because I believe in a way, since you came from such a small town in the US, but in the last 4 or 5 years you have been traveling around the world, working around the world, and mm-hmm. then as you said, you also have friends all over the world. You you interact with so many different cultures. Mm-hmm. For sure, you take in it into yourself as well, right? So definitely we change so much of who we were before we travel and lived abroad. So how we can deal with that change in our daily life, that's gonna be our main topic to discuss for today.
Sounds good.
Are you ready for the next part?
I think I'm ready.
Okay, so let's go through a little bit of your story and the reason why we chose this topic, I guess. But before we explain the reason to our audience, let's tell a little bit about the story. Why did you decide to book that one-way ticket from the US? I never actually have a return ticket since then.
So basically I was a college student. I was in my last semester of college, and at that point I had already worked enough and gained enough experience to the point where I was freelancing. But I had a decision to make. I could either like go into full-time work and mm-hmm. stay in the US, or I could take this opportunity to pursue this desire I had to travel at the time, even though I had left the country like twice in my life at that point. But I just felt this strong desire to travel. So mm-hmm. I decided to take freelancing on the road with me, and somehow convinced my two clients at the time to keep me on as a 20-year-old or whatever and go off and travel. I booked a one-way ticket, even though I had never even like eaten a meal alone. So I was terrified just to solo travel. That wasn't my initial intention, but I also didn't want to wait around for anyone to go with me. So I ended up taking off on the one-way flight on what was supposed to be like a few months of traveling before I came back and got a real person job and mm-hmm. yada yada. And now almost 4.5 years later, I think now,
mm-hmm.
I still haven't gone home, and truthfully, I don't know that I ever will. So
yeah,
that's kind of what inspired the start.
What was the first country that you went to?
Portugal. Actually, Lisbon was the first city.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Full circle. We're in Lisbon right now. But
yeah, we met each other here. So far, Lisbon has become such a special place for me as well.
Yeah, I think it has, like, this weird pull to it. I feel like it pulls a lot of people here.
Yeah.
But, yeah, this was my first stop. And when I first came, I think this was, like, my fourth country ever.
Mm-hmm.
And now I've hit 30, 30, 31, I can't remember. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I've spent a lot of the last few years traveling a mm-hmm. lot.
Okay. And what are the maybe three biggest lessons that you learned from your travel? You don't have to take three. If you have one or two or even four, you can share.
I think one of the biggest ones for me as like a solo traveler especially was like learning how to be comfortable with myself.
Mm.
I don't know why it's seemingly like the scariest thing in the world to be alone with yourself, because like in reality you're always alone with yourself. But I hadn't done many things on my own, and I had never really like taken the time to think through what I actually enjoyed doing. I think I was just going with what my friends liked or the masses. And so when you got like an entire open itinerary that's all up to you, and everything that you do is kind of like your decision, you learn a lot about what you like and don't like. And then I think I also learned a lot about just like being open to other people and other cultures, because I've encountered so many different things in the last few years that I definitely wasn't used to back in the States, especially in Ohio. And I think that openness is what's like made my experience so much better, because I have like friends of all different backgrounds, of all different ages, and I've gotten to experience a lot of different things in my travels that I probably otherwise wouldn't have.
Yeah, and definitely it's the best way for us to understand more about ourselves.
Yeah.
Because I don't think we are taught to sit just by ourselves and to enjoy everything just by ourselves.
It's so weird that it's so uncomfortable, but
yeah, but the more you do,
yeah,
maybe the more comfortable. But I have to say, like, I think it always make you feel like a little bit like nervous to go somewhere alone by yourself. But it just like, you know, nothing gonna bad happen or that kind of thing. Because if I have to go to a place or a party by myself, at the beginning I'm still feel a little bit like, oh, I don't know, you know, and then you need to make maybe a first step to say hi to someone.
Yeah.
But because you've been there, done that, so you're like, okay, I'm gonna go again. What is the matter? So it just makes us easier to say yes to the unknown, I think, when you're a solo traveler.
It totally changes your experience too. Like, there are some things that I prefer to do alone now than in groups, because I feel like sometimes when you're in a group, you don't end up doing all the things you do when you're solo.
Yeah, and then you can just make the decision that the best for you.
Exactly. You can sleep in when you want to. Yeah. There's no itinerary.
Oh, all right. So let's move a little bit further to that. So I think within that 30 countries that you've been traveling the last 4.5 years, you have tons of people that you met.
Mm-hmm.
You have a lot of, I think, friends, and the relationship that you built with them that I think never make goodbye easy, right? You come to the place, and of course the place is beautiful, but at the end of the day, I think the people that you met, you interact with, the one that you made memories with, actually the one that stay in our heart.
Yeah.
Right? So I think that the conversation that we had the other day at the dinner, and then that why we chose it topic, because we think that we talk a lot about like a relationship, like romantic relationship breakup, but with friends breakup, when we move around and suddenly we don't talk with that friends anymore, of course it's sad, and how we actually like deal with that emotions, and we don't talk about that often because we just feel like, oh, that's it. It kind of fade.
Yeah,
I think friendship breakup at some point, it just fade slowly away. Not like breakup with your boyfriend or girlfriend, just like bye.
Yeah.
And then, but of course, it still make us feel, yeah, maybe the word painful is not the one that I'm looking for, but like we sad.
Because it is like something you have to grieve, I think.
Yeah, like something you need to grieve. So how have you been dealing with that by moving a lot around the world?
Yeah, I mean, I'm definitely not an expert on the subject matter, so I'm still trying to figure out how to deal with some of the changing friendships and things like that. But I actually think that, like, my decision to go from traveling all the time to being more of an expat where I stay in one place was in part due to all of the goodbyes I was saying, because for me, it's really hard to say those goodbyes and painful to like not get to spend my days with some of the people that I had met traveling and built these strong connections with. And you know, you meet like a lot of friends traveling that are just they're friends and they're travel friends, but they're not close friends. But then you meet plenty of others that are, they become best friends and they become family, and I think those are the relationships that are harder to say goodbye to. And a lot of times, like, the breakups or the friendship losses don't necessarily happen, like you said, in, like, a big fight or anything like that. They just happen because you live in different parts of the world, or you guys don't have the same life circumstances anymore, so one person doesn't have the energy needed to put forth into the relationship anymore. So
yeah.
I think with kind of navigating some of those changes, one of the things that I've done is to just, like, try to check in with my energy levels and see, like, which relationships I'm really putting my active energy into at each point in time.
Mm-hmm.
And just because I'm not putting energy towards a friendship doesn't mean we can't be friends in the future, but it means I'm not putting energy into that friendship now.
Yeah, and definitely I think we don't take it personal.
Yeah.
Anymore. Like, it's not my fault, it's not your fault, that kind of
it's
thing.
It's life sometimes.
Yeah, it's life. We accept that we have different paths and different things that we care for.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the reason why. Yeah, I think the biggest lesson for me to learn how to accept, it's just not like we don't love each other anymore as a friends.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it's we met each other at that point in our life, and we have, let's say, the beautiful chapter together, but then we apart.
Yeah.
So yeah,
I think also too, like, one thing that I've definitely had to adapt to is kind of how my friendships are with people back home. Because some of my, like, longest time friendships that I would still consider friends are always going to be different relationships than some of the ones I've met traveling, because there's this whole side of my life that those people just will never be able to relate to.
Yeah.
They haven't, like, had the experience or met the people or been in the places to fully understand what I'm going through. And then time zone wise too, we don't always keep an active touch, but we miss a lot of the big moments in each other's lives. And so I think there's also that grief that comes with not having, like, that old part of your identity as actively in your life.
Okay. I have another question for you.
Okay.
So throughout all that friendship, let's say, like, breakouts. What are the positive lessons or change that you see in yourself from that relationship?
Yeah, I think sometimes breakups can be a positive thing because they give you the freedom to enter this new season of your life and kind of shed whatever that old identity was with that friendship. But then they also just give you so much more energy to put towards other areas of your life and other people. During that season. And it's not to say that, like, the friendship that you've broken up with doesn't deserve, like, the same level of, like, love and energy or anything like that, but I think it's totally okay and positive to walk away from certain relationships that aren't serving you anymore and kind of, like, step into this positive new era of, like, really surrounding yourself by people that can help build you up in whatever season you're in.
Yeah. And I think a relationship, a friendship, needs to, how to say, like, give us energy instead of draining energy from us.
For sure.
For me, I used to be such a friend that I really want to ask my friend, like, I really in touch with them. So I feel like, oh, if my friend busy, because I'm never be the one who in a romantic relationship. So I never be, like, busy with my boyfriend, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
So I feel like, oh, I kind of have more time than them. So I put, like, oh, I would ask them to make plan and blah, all that kind of thing. But then at the end, I feel there's some certain events happened that make me feel like people always cancel on me. You know?
I'm the same way, girl. I feel you.
And people would put me not as priority, like the way I prioritize them.
Mm-hmm.
And then, when they don't have thing with their boyfriend or their family, and then they have some free time, and then they call me.
Yeah.
And then it just happened a lot. Like, I'm like, huh? I am the backup plan, because I never treat those people as my backup plan.
Mm-hmm.
I put them as my first choice if I have time. So, of course, it happened a lot to the point, like, at first, of course, I would take the blame on me. Mm-hmm. Like, oh, maybe I'm just too sensitive. I'm just asking too much, for example, from my friends. But then I'm like, rethink a bit. If I put in an A, I would love my friend also put in an A, right?
Yeah.
And if it's not a match, then maybe I shouldn't put so much time and effort and even my thought on it.
Exactly.
And just let things flow. Yeah. And it hurts in the beginning because you're like, oh, maybe I should try harder. That kind of thing, you know?
Yeah.
But then you just like, people who would put time, effort on you, other people we're gonna stay.
Yeah. Exactly, and I think too, like, if you continue to like drain yourself of your energy completely, you're gonna end up feeling resentment towards people, and they don't necessarily deserve that. Maybe they're just not, you're no longer in a season where you're compatible friends.
Yeah,
I don't think that like the end of one friendship means that they weren't ever a friend to you. It just means that they can't be a friend to you now.
Yeah, that's true. And maybe we still care for each other. It just we not happen to be in each other's life that often. That's it. Because in I used to live in the Netherlands before for mm-hmm. almost 5 years. And of course, I feel like that my family, the second family there. And then when I moved here to Lisbon, not so many of my friends actually came here to visit me as I wish. So I just feel like, oh, they forget me. Why didn't they make it here to visit me? Like the first year I flew back to the Netherlands a lot because I just feel like, oh, they miss me, I'm gonna come back to see them. Mm-hmm. But of course life is evolved, our life get evolving, and yeah, they have a group of friends that in there, and I have a group of friends here, and I don't, like you said, I don't feel resentment in the sense that I let it go. Mm-hmm. They still gonna be my good friends, but not the friends that can give me constant support mm-hmm. in the life that I experience now in this city. So I feel maybe less stressed and just accept with it.
Yeah. Have you ever heard of the sum of five theory, actually?
No.
It's like,
share with us.
I remember a professor at my university had given us this whole speech on it. Basically, the theory is that you're the sum of the five people closest to you at any point in time.
Mm.
So, like, naturally, as you grow and go into different seasons of your life, those five people will change. And so it's important to be cognizant of, like, who you're keeping close to you, because those people at the end of the day will shape who you become and who you are at mm-hmm. any point in time. So
yeah.
I think that says a lot about friendships and the energy we put forth.
Yeah.
People.
Yeah, definitely. If I look at my circle right now in Lisbon, most of them are entrepreneurs. Are working remotely.
Yeah.
Don't have the job at the office, none of them having own a house or having a baby, still making travel plans a lot,
mm-hmm.
Are always up for like, hey, let's do things spontaneously, that kind of thing. So that the circle right now I have in Lisbon, and yeah, and if I count, yeah, I think the older we get as well, you don't have a big circle anymore. And
that's okay, though.
Yeah.
I think having too many people sometimes thins out the energy you could put towards each friendship. So.
Yeah. I would love to say that, if I can take my time back when I'm a little bit younger, mm-hmm. I would love to learn more about the energy.
Yeah, me too.
Like, what... Yeah, because I think at the end of the day, it's how we feel inside,
mm-hmm.
and we need to protect our energy.
Yeah, and it impacts everything else in life, too.
Yeah.
So if you put too much into friendships, you're going to have less to put towards other things. And
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like this, so you travel a lot, you interact with a lot of culture, and the yourself 4.5 years ago and now, mm-hmm. are different.
Absolutely, for mm-hmm. sure.
How you cope with those changes on the way you travel,
mm-hmm.
like with culture, with people, even with time zone, even with the food, those small things. What are your recipe
for example, if someone listened to those stories and then they never traveled before and they kind of freak out like, oh my God, I'm gonna be on my own.
Mm-hmm.
So what can you tell to someone that...
Like what advice?
Yeah, what advice?
I think that, well, one of the biggest pieces of advice is to be open, like remain open to all things and don't enter into any situation thinking that like your way and the way that you've always known is the only way. Because there's a lot of right ways to live life, and there's not that many wrong ways. So I think keeping that in mind when you experience cultures or new experiences or really anything in life is important. And then I think also kind of going in line with that, like being adaptable. So like not fixating your expectations on like one thing happening and everything's going to go according to plan, or... setting your expectations that a certain place is going to feel a certain way or be a certain way. Because I think whenever you set those expectations, you set yourself up for... Yeah, you set yourself up for failure.
Yeah, failure.
Failure. Yeah. So I think that's another lesson. And then I think the last one would be to just, like, be gentle with yourself, because you're going to feel a lot of different ways depending on where you're at in your journey. And so... You know, how I felt at the beginning of traveling 4.5 years ago is way different than how I felt at the end. Because at the beginning, I was just like super eager and excited to go and see as many things as I could and experience everything and meet all the people. And then, you know, after the pandemic, I was more of like a slow-mad. Like I would spend like at least like three months in each place. Really would like try to settle into a place, build a routine. And then I think when I decided to settle a little bit more and become more of an expat, I just was ready for different things. And so I think you have to be cognizant of what you need at different points.
Yeah, definitely. I feel a little bit the same in a way that at the beginning of my digital nomad, I always feel like the need, oh, I need to book that flight. Yeah. I need to go. But now, after for a while, I'm like, it's okay. You get tired. And then no fear of missing out, you know? Like, you're afraid that, oh, I've not been in this place. But at the end of the day, I think you can always make one place become more excited, become more exciting and special to you just with people around you, and there's so much more to experience than just moving around. Of course, everyone is different.
Yeah.
Some people need that. But for me, after the last 2 years, just moving too much, this year I actually put down like, I want to make Lisbon feel more like my home.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, oh, and if I can add anything from that, from the things that you just mentioned, I think for me, I would advise that people come and go in your life.
Yeah.
As much as you have a lot of love to give to others, others also have a lot of love to give to you. You need to learn what is the best for you and how to be the most comfortable with yourself. Because again, at the end of the day,
if that's the only one you got.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Yeah. So just spend time to learn more about yourself and invest on yourself, I think.
Yeah, I think that's important.
Yeah. Because I don't think when we are at school or we grew up, we are taught to invest in art.
Mm-hmm.
Right? People gonna say, oh, you should do this, do that. But like, what is the learning about ourselves? So I think, yeah, the last 2 years for me, I just spent everything on me in this way that I explore, I learned, and I'm like, isn't that great? I'm gonna end this conversation with the last questions.
Okay.
Maybe it seemed like general questions, but what are your go-to, let's say, ways of dealing with, let's say, sadness, anxiety when those changes happen in your life?
Yeah. Well, I know you asked early on if I, like, when the last time I cried was.
Yeah.
Crying is one way I cope. I've definitely come to realize that as embarrassing as it could be to, like, you know, be crying in the park or something like that, mm-hmm. sometimes it's actually, like, a really healthy release. And for mm-hmm. me, it's helped just, like, grieve certain things and get them out of my system. Writing, I think, definitely helps a lot, like, journaling. Therapy can help as well. But then I think just being mindful in certain situations and giving yourself like the space and I guess support you need to like mm-hmm. flow through some of those different periods mm-hmm. is really important. So that can look like a ton of different things. For me, like I really have found a couple of like mindfulness oriented books helpful and things like that. And then just keeping the people, I guess the people in my life close as like a support system during some of it. I don't know if that answers your question, but.
Definitely. But I can summarize so people can take note of your advice. Yeah. So crying is beautiful. It can help you to release whatever emotion that gets stuck in your body. Mm-hmm. The second thing is writing, because of course you are a writer.
Yeah, gotta get it out of your head.
Yeah, and free writing, I think it's actually very nice to just like get it also on the paper, and then actually when you read it, you're like, oh, it's fine.
It's fine, and then when you look back at it later, it makes everything feel small.
Yeah, like, why am I freaking out at this moment? And it's nice to look back those notes 1 year ago or even just 3 months ago, and you see how much change that you make, and you can be proud of yourself. The second thing is being mindful. What you do, even people you have in your life, and keeping them as your support system, not your draining and energy system. And then the last one is, I guess, seek for professional help when you need, as such as therapy.
Yeah, and I think there's lots of different ways to seek therapy, whether it's an actual therapist or meditation or yoga.
Yeah, or even just pick on a podcast to listen to, for example, this. Yeah, so I guess this is. Thank you so much, Jordan, for joining us on the Amplify Your Confidence podcast. I find it super nice to have a friend on the podcast, because somehow you feel like, oh, it's another way actually for you to understand more about your friends, and there's so much more things that we can learn about each other and we didn't know before. So this is beautiful, and thank you so much for everyone who tune in to listen to this podcast. If you want to connect to Jordan, I'm gonna put all the information in the descriptions. If you need a writer for your brands or something like that, you can always reach out to her. And don't forget to give me a feedback for this podcast, put on a rating so more people can find me on all the other channels of the podcast. Also give me a follow on my Instagram, Amplify Your Confidence _ podcast. And that's it. Thank you so much for listening. I'm gonna see you at the next episode. Bye bye.